Holy words.
The Glendale Road Church of Christ proudly presents a weekly exploration of the Word of our living God. This is It Is Written with Minister Stephen Hunter.
Oh, let the ancient words impart.
Whatever you do, never let anybody convince you or have you buy into the notion that God doesn't care. Or never let anyone talk you into believing that because of life circumstances or whatever you're going through or have gone through, that God wasn't there. It's written in Psalm 56, I believe verse 6 or 8, somewhere in that neighborhood. You've captured my tears in a jar, the psalmist writes. Then we go all the way to the Sermon on the Mount, and Jesus says that God is so vigilant over His creation that He takes notice when even a sparrow falls from the sky. And He goes on in that same context, and He says that all the hairs of your head are numbered and known by God. Then you go all the way to 1 Peter, and Peter says, let us cast our cares on Him because He cares for us. Some versions say, let us cast all our anxieties on Him because He cares for us. A father who happened to have a very prominent position, leader of a synagogue, goes to Jesus. But in that moment, it didn't matter that he was a leader of the synagogue. In that moment, it didn't matter all the credentials that he had, all the authority that he might have exercised, or the influence that he might have yielded in Israel. The only thing that mattered to him at that point was that his daughter was sick and that she was dying. And so he goes to Jesus, and he asks Jesus to come along. And Jesus does. Sandwiched in between this story is another story of a woman who had the flow of blood for 12 years. And she touched the hem of Jesus' garment, and because she believed, she was healed immediately. And so you look, corresponding, this woman had suffered for 12 years, and in her story, we read that she had sought all the physicians of the day. She had seen doctor after doctor after doctor, nothing. But she touches Jesus' garment in faith, and in Matthew and also in Luke, some of those versions say Jesus perceived that His power went out from Him, and He said, who was it that touched Me? But then you get back on track, and when they get back to the story of the daddy, Jairus, and he and this entourage, along with Christ, are headed back to his house to see over his 12-year-old little girl who lay sick and dying. Some of the folks come to him and they said, she's already passed away. Why bother the teacher any further? And sometimes folks are that way. Well, you know, look at how bad things have got. You know, why bother God? Why trust in God? Why keep being faithful to God, or whatever the case is. And sometimes life circumstances has the ability to really allow us to believe that because bad has happened to us, God doesn't care. Because evil has come upon us, that God is so removed from our circumstances. And one of the hardest questions that preachers face, and that sometimes any Christian faces when trying to minister to others, is why is this happening to me? Where is God? Doesn't He care? This, that, and the other. And the only answer that I have ever found that is somewhat helpful to me is that, you know, God is in the very same place in my misery that He was when His Son lay dying on the cross. You see, God isn't so far removed from personal suffering. He sent His Son in the flesh, and His Son was falsely accused, was hated, was spat upon, was deserted by His inner circle, was treated like a common thief and criminal, and crucified after having been beaten. God has a little bit of a handle on what it's like to be subject to the evil of the world. But they say, she's already passed, why bother the teacher? But Jesus presses on. And in those days, somewhat similar to ours, maybe a little bit different, there were some conditions that existed that were not as flattering. For example, about 60% of children died in their teen years. And that is even those who survived birth. You see, they didn't have the advances in science and medicine that we have. And so a lot of women died in childbirth, a lot of children died in childbirth. And if they did survive and live, many of them died in their teens because they didn't have inoculations. They didn't have, you know, the shots that you get for this, that, or the other. And sometimes they were not as aware of sanitation as we are today. We have out here on the visitor's desk this big old bottle of stuff. You put that gel on your hand or whatever it is and kills germs. They didn't have that. They didn't bathe every day like we did. You know, ancient cities and ancient people stunk, to put it as honestly as possible. People didn't have bathrooms in their own houses or baths. They had public baths. Any of you have ever visited Turkey, you probably know that there are still, in parts of that part of the world, there are still public bathhouses where folks go and bathe. Because unless you were wealthy in those days, you didn't have a bath in your own house. So a lot of things were different. And she did pass away, and all these wailers and mourners are there because burial usually took place on the same day. Jeremiah 9, verses 17 through 19 depicts this, saying that, you know, the mourners were to be called and things of that sort. And sometimes you would have family that would come in, and you would also have professional mourners. Their job was to show up and just to wail and carry on. Now, I forgot who it was. One of my mother's kin had died in South Nashville, where the funeral was, at this funeral home. And in that area, when I grew up there, it was predominantly Caucasian. Now it's, you have Hispanics, you have Middle Easterners, and so forth. Well, we were at the funeral home. Stephanie probably remembers this, but we're there at the funeral home, and all of a sudden, this awful ruckus begins of people. I mean, we didn't know what was going on, but there were some, I guess, Ethiopians in one of the other viewing rooms, and according to their religious belief, their religious leader would come in, and at appointed times, he would say, okay, go, and they'd just, they'd carry on wailing and stuff. And it lasted a few seconds, and then it stopped as quickly as it started. And the funeral director came running down, and he was like, it's okay, everything. Is the house on fire? What's going on? And all these people, he said, it's okay. Sorry, it's their custom. It's their thing. They have appointed times for wailing. Now, this is something totally unknown to us because as Westerners, as Americans, we go and we have the stiff upper lip, or at least we try to. But some of these more Eastern cultures and folks, oh man, they'll just wail out loud and carry on. And so Jesus gets there and he goes into the place and he said, what's all this racket? What's all this noise? All this wailing and so forth. Now, he's not saying don't mourn, but he's about to point out something far greater than that. Now, in this passage, what he says that's given to us in Aramaic is translated. Now, in a lot of the ancient religions of the world in Jesus' time, a lot of the, if you will, magic was wrapped up in not knowing the secrets. And so you probably go, why does Mark put this Aramaic phrase and then translate it? Well, he does that for the sake of people in his own time who would have understood that if a phrase was spoken, it would have been perceived as an incantation or some sort of, you know, it's kind of like when abracadabra, right? When the magician goes abracadabra, that's supposed to be magical. But the fact that he translated it, he's trying to prove to his audience that Christianity is not magic. It's the real deal. But what we find in this text is that Jesus is the master of both life and death. All the way in Deuteronomy 32, 39, God said, now see that I am He, and there's no God besides me. I kill and I make alive. You know, we think a lot about God being the God, the Savior of our souls, and we very seldom really reflect on the reality that God will also one day to all those who are in the ground give the resurrection. Paul wrote to the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning verse 13, he said, I wouldn't have you to be ignorant, brethren, that you do not mourn as those who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, God will certainly bring with Him those who are asleep in Christ. This we say to you by the word of the Lord, he goes on. And in that entire passage, 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18, it becomes evident that the Thessalonians believed that when some of their kin had died as Christians, that, well, they just missed out. And that was very much tied to the Epicureanism of the times. Epicureanism was a popular philosophical sort of thinking back in those days, and a lot of people believed that when you died, that was it. You're just gone. Nothing else. But Paul comes along and he says, no, these who are Christians, those who have fallen asleep in Christ, they will be raised, they will be resurrected, and they will be with Christ. They haven't been, as this popular book series calls it, left behind. God is as much the master of life and death. We read in 1 Samuel 2:6, the Lord kills and makes alive. He brings down to the grave and He brings up. Acts 17:28, for in Him we live and move and have our being. One day all those who have died, good or bad, Christian or non-Christian, will be raised. And there will be this great judgment scene where we give an account of what we did in our lives, if we lived in faithfulness to God, or if we followed our own paths. And the hope of the resurrection that we as Christians have doesn't mean that we won't mourn, but that we shouldn't mourn as those who have no hope. And all the way back in Daniel 12, verse 2, this is pointed out. Many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall wake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. Even our Lord in John 5, 28 and 29, the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear His voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. Everybody will be raised. All graves will be opened. And we will come back and we will give an account to God. And even from Mark's gospel, I would point out that what Jesus said was that God is the God of the living and not the dead. And when He revealed Himself to Moses at the burning bush, which is the incident that Mark is pointing out in Mark 12, 26 and 27, He said that He was the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, who had been dead for years. But by this very fact, Jesus says that God is the God of the living and not the dead. Now, if you have your Bibles, open them to 1 Corinthians 15, please. 1 Corinthians is right before 2 Corinthians, if it gives you any indication. Right after the book of Romans. And if you don't know where any of this is, if you have one of these Bibles, you have a table of contents in there that'll give you an idea as to where to turn. Even in the first century, there were those who were Christians, but that did not necessarily believe in the resurrection. And Paul, in giving a defense of believing in the resurrection, makes some observations, if you will, in 1 Corinthians 15, that if we don't believe in it, here's what we have to be willing to admit. First of all, in verses 13 and 16 of 1 Corinthians 15, he says, verse 13, if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. Verse 16, for if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. So this is where he begins on the elementary foundational level of our faith. If you don't believe in the resurrection, if the dead do not rise, then Christ has not been raised. Okay, Paul, that's well and fine. But he goes on, verse 14, and he says there, and if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. So if there is no resurrection, Jesus hasn't been raised, and our faith is very much in vain. And in verse 15, he says as much, that we are found false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that He raised up Christ, whom He hasn't raised, if in fact the dead do not rise. So pretty much preaching is a lie. Now I know some of you believe preaching is a lie to begin with, and you don't need to believe or disbelieve in the resurrection for this. As the audience sits very tensely, not wanting to smile or laugh. But the gospel preaching, the essential gospel preaching that Paul points out in the first four verses of 1 Corinthians 15 that Christ died, was buried, and was raised again in accordance with the Scriptures. That's the gospel. The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. If He wasn't raised, our faith is in vain, preaching is a lie, but what's more, verse 17, we are still in our sins. Your faith is futile, he says, and as much you're still in your sins. And verses 18 and 19, then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. Let me ask you just a very honest question. Most of us, if not all of us, at some point in life have shed tears, have cried about something that's happened. And that's just human. It's human to be heartbroken when heartbreaking things happen. But what's so lovely about our faith is that God takes our sorrow and He has a way of turning it into joy. This little girl lay dying on her bed. Her daddy goes, as any loving father would, and tries to find someone, somewhere, somehow, that she can be helped. And while they're in transit back, some come and they say she's passed away. Why bother the teacher any further? But Jesus presses on. And He presses on with the crowd, with the entourage. He comes to the house, and there that little girl lay dead, and everyone's wailing and mourning over her loss. A tragic event indeed. And He puts them out of the house, except for a few. And even among all His apostles, He only keeps Peter, James, and John. So you think about all the followers that He had. He whittled it down to 12 that He would call apostles. And out of that 12, He whittled it down to 3 who were the most intimate of His apostles. And they stay behind. And He pronounces to this girl in Aramaic a phrase that's translated as, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." And she does. And we see other examples throughout the Gospels. For example, one of the other Gospels, there's a woman who's going along. She's a widow, and her son is being carried to his final resting place because he has died. And Jesus says to that boy, "Arise," and he arises right then and there. And then we all know probably about the story of Lazarus when he had died, and He says to Lazarus, "Come forth out of the tomb." And Lazarus does, got the wrap all over him and everything. Jesus took the sorrow of these people and He turned it into joy because of the resurrection. If you've been in a funeral home recently, to console or to be consoled, there in a box, a casket, if you will, has been a loved one of yours or someone else's. Maybe it was expected, maybe it was a complete shock. But that sorrow one day can be turned into joy. Because God doesn't leave us entirely hopeless. God doesn't leave us entirely bereft. And you know, if we hope, even as Christians, in this life, then it will be the greatest tragedy we've ever faced. But where is our faith there in those funeral homes, with our loved ones who are mourning, or with ourselves? Where is our faith that one day this body will be raised again and God will judge all of us? Those of us who have lived faithfully to Him, we will receive the welcoming invitation into His presence for all eternity. But those that haven't, they'll be sent away to eternal condemnation. The earliest memory I ever have of a funeral was some relative of my mother's when I was a wee little boy. And we went out to East Tennessee, which is right across, obviously, the border of eastern Kentucky. And I thought it was odd, and I have a faint memory of this. I was very small, probably five or under. And they had the body in the casket in the house. Now, for those of you that don't know, that used to be how it was done. There weren't funeral homes everywhere, and some folks couldn't afford the services of the funeral home, and they would do what they could and have the body in the house. And my mother's family in that part of Tennessee and Kentucky, that's what they did. Someone died, they'd prepare the body, put it in the casket, have it in the house. And I remember just being afraid. I didn't know people did that, but some did. But then I get to middle school, and I have two great grandparents that passed away in middle school and high school. And so there you go to another funeral. And then my senior year of high school, one of my best friends dies in a car wreck. He was a year younger than I was, 17. He was. And then you go on from there, and you have Graham and Granddaddy that passes away. You have Mama and all the... I say this not to say that I'm insensitive towards loss, because it does hurt. It is sad. But in the midst of loss, to avoid keeping from losing myself in the loss, I look to the hope that God has given us. You know, last Monday I mentioned to you I had an aunt's funeral that I would have to preach. And boy, my stomach was in all sorts of knots, you know. But I made it through. We got back home. Praise God, I survived. Hated it. But one day she shall be raised. My wife has had a miscarriage, never even got to hold that baby. One day, he or she shall be raised. If this life is all that I have to hope in, the loss is horrible. But because we are Christians, God says, here's hope that I give to you. The hope of the resurrection. And if the Lord comes first and some of us don't die, then that's fine and well. But don't ever forget that those of your loved ones and those of my loved ones that have ever passed away, that we have mourned over, those empty chairs come Thanksgiving and Christmas, that we look and bring us to tears, these things one day shall be no more. We have the hope of the resurrection, and Jesus, in His compassion and love and care, raised this little girl and gave her back to her daddy. And you know, I kind of believe that sometimes those who have gone on before us, and again, if you're hurting, I don't mean to be insensitive, but sometimes I think that those who have gone on before us are in a lot better shape than we are right now. Now, I know selfishly I want them back, right? Selfishly, I want them with me. I know you want yours with you. And I understand that. But one day, our sorrow, by God's grace, will be turned into joy. Just as this father's sorrow was turned into joy. Bow with me, please, and let's pray. Our Holy Father in heaven, we thank You and praise You for the hope of the resurrection. Father, I pray for those who are listening, those who are here at Glendale. Many of our brothers and sisters have recently suffered losses. Some of them may have occurred years ago, and they're still hurting from that loss. Comfort them, Father, I pray. And I pray that their hearts would be encouraged by the hope of the resurrection that we have through Christ our Lord. Loss is an inevitable part of life, and we're never ready for it, even if we think that we are. But help us to focus our hearts and our minds on being with You. For the Scripture says To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And where you are, Father, we know there are no diseases, there are no sicknesses, there are no hospitals or funeral homes, there are no police stations. For there with you, Father, we're made whole again, as it was intended from creation. Comfort our grieving brothers and sisters here. Help us to be a blessing to them in their grief. And we thank you for such encouraging stories as Jairus and his little girl. And we look forward to the time when you return to this earth, Father, and the dead rise. And we just pray that we would be found faithful, having obeyed your commandments, that when that resurrection day comes, that, Father, we get to enjoy the blessing of your presence for all eternity. Be with us, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. All right. We're going to get ready and have our song of invitation. But just give me your attention just a little bit longer. There is one resurrection to which right now I want to invite you if you have not already partaken in it. And that is the resurrection that is afforded by faith if you believe that Christ is Lord in baptism. Baptism is a reenactment of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And if you have faith that Christ is God's Son and are willing to confess that He is Lord and to turn towards God and away from chasing after the ways of the flesh, to be buried with Him in baptism means that, as the Bible says, your sins will be washed away. And you go down into the water as the sinful person. And while under the water with Christ, you die. And when you come up from the water, you are resurrected. Raised again, as Paul says in Romans 6, to walk in newness of life. In order to really live, you've got to be willing first to die. Will you put to death that person of flesh this morning and be raised again with Christ by faith? If so, come forward while we stand and sing.
This has been It Is Written, presented by the Glendale Road Church of Christ. We welcome your visits and communications at any time.
With God's own heart, oh, let the ancient words impart.